Greetings, Earthlings. Hello. Hello. My name's Tony Crider. I'm in the Department of Physics here. My co-presenter today is Anthony Weston, Department of Philosophy
and
Environmental Studies. Today we're going to give you a talk. We haven't decided if it's called Beyond Earth Day or Beyond Earth Day. Those are two very different sentiments, right? The title of the talk today is Beyond Earth Day. But do we mean looking at things beyond Earth for a day? Or do we mean looking beyond this notion of Earth Day? And which Earth Day is coming up quite soon?
Saturday.
So if you close your eyes, actually you don't have to close your eyes, you can look up at the front. Here's an image that you might expect if we were thinking of Earth Day. Like it's that standard Apollo 17 photo of the Earth taken from space where you can see the whole Earth with no shadows.
Which when I was born didn't exist. This was a photo, was it 68, 67?
Yeah.
No one had seen the Earth like this until then. But this was a transformative moment for us to see the whole planet as a planet.
Some argue that a photo like this is one of the things that helped inspire Earth Day itself. You might imagine photos that look like the next one, which are slightly cheesy pictures that you would see at the college
coffee of Sammy the Squirrel handing out gear tagged with Earth Day on it. There's me with the eco-friendly cup, and that's something we kind of do on Earth Day. A standard Earth Day is to think about, you know, our impact on the environment, and to think about the planet, and those are all good things to do. We're trying to go just a little bit beyond that today. So we're going to start with not those two photos, but another photo that was actually sent into space by NASA such that if aliens found it, they would be able to say what it was. Here, we're going to reveal it piece by piece, and at each end, I'm not going to ask for a show of hands or raising hands. I can't even raise my hand right now if I wanted, all right? I will ask you to just shout out. What do you see? What do you think this is? Shout.
Car.
What do you see with your eyeballs? What does it look like? What aspects of it do you notice? If you can't tell what it is, what can you tell about it? What'd you say? There's reflection. It looks like there's reflections in it. That's a good thing to pick out. Anything else?
People up here are saying black and white.
They're seeing a lot of black and white.
Colors.
All right, let's pull up another piece. What do you see? Looks like water. What else? I'll just pick on tables. What do you see? A cliff. All right. What do you see? Crater? I heard crater from somewhere. Cratering? All right. Let's go on. Let's look at the next piece. What do you see coming over here? Looks like a snake. They're thinking it's a snake. All right. Keep going, next piece. What do you see?
Black.
All right, not a lot of data in that piece, all right?
Let's Black's drop. Data.
What?
A lot of data in that, sure there's yeah. data.
What do you see? What do you see?
A tongue.
We gotta have a tongue. Any other guesses? A what? A face, a part of a face and a tongue. All right, let's drop that in place. All right, what do you see? Oh, we're starting to say it's an arm, a shirt. All right, drop it in. Yeah, that's pretty easy to pick out. One of the first things that humans can detect when their baby's being born, they can pick out eyes. A sandwich. Grilled cheese sandwich. Very good.
With a bite out of it.
Yeah, what's wrong with that grilled cheese sandwich? We'll find out in a little bit. Keep going. What is that? What do you think? What do you see? What do you see?
Drinking rainwater.
What? Someone drinking rainwater. All right, let's drop it in place. And we're about ready for the reveal. What do you think that is? Wrist? Someone's hands? Some game of rock, paper, scissors? Let's reveal the background. There is the full photo revealed. There are still mysteries and things hidden in it. What is wrong with this photo? What is weird about this photo? I hear an everything. Tell me something that's odd about this photo. Well, it's a little bit grainy. In fact, this is a grainy photo because it was made low resolution. They had to make it low resolution to be able to send it into space the way they did. That the technology required them to send low resolution photos. All right. What else is weird about this photo? This is not a difficult question.
Cara, go ahead.
Yeah.
Go ahead.
Dude is drinking from a pitcher
like this, right?
How many of you drank from a pitcher like that before? No, that's not how we drink. We drink like he is drinking there right in the back. Back row, yeah, he just took a sip. Do it again. Show us how to take a sip. Yeah, that's how it's done. Why would, if we were trying to show aliens how we drink, why would we do it like that? Why would you do it like that? There's another hint in the sandwich. What's wrong with that sandwich? Is that how you eat a grilled cheese sandwich? What happened there? He took a bite, turned it around, and took a bite on the other side. Why would you take a photo like that where you have one side of the sandwich and then the other side? If it was just him taking a bite out of the sandwich, would they know that he had eaten some of it? No. The point of having that extra bite was to show this is how humans eat. We take bites out of things. But unfortunately, you have to exaggerate that for the still photo because they could not send video. They didn't have the technology to encode video into this. So they had to take photos that made it clear, yes, this is someone eating ice cream. This is someone eating a sandwich. This is someone drinking water. And so clearly water was going from a vessel into the human, all right?
Let's talk about the context of all this. So we said, Tony said that this is a photograph sent to space, which is kind of a curious business. Like, first of all, how do you think about sending photographs to space that represent the human somehow or other? And then this one in particular, but let's talk about the context. So Explorer was one and Pioneer was the other. In the early 70s, NASA is sending spacecraft on what they call a grand tour of the outer planets, Jupiter, Saturn, Uranus. Oh, wait, let's go back a second. So they knew eventually this spacecraft, always gaining velocity, would escape the solar system, would go past the orbit of Pluto, which then was the boundary of the solar system. And so what happens then? There's a spacecraft floating off into interstellar space. Maybe in 10,000 years, maybe in 10 million years, someone else encounters it, some other intelligence. So it's clearly an artifact. Who produced it? Could there be, shouldn't there be some kind of message, some kind of indication of who sent it? In the meantime, when it got past Pluto, one of the things that happened is this. They turned it around, it's cameras, they turned it around and took a picture of the solar system from outside it. this is like the next step. If you think about the picture of Earth that we started with, and I said, when I was born, that picture didn't exist. That was a cultural transformation, to take a picture of the Earth from outside the Earth, and it changed people's heads. What is this whole planet, this precious little thing floating in space, as opposed to, like, it doesn't feel like that every day, right? It's a big place, and there are lots of other places we don't think about much. You think about it as a planet, as a single whole, that's a different thing. Then you're much more conscious of its limits, maybe, of its fragility, of its preciousness, all those things that kind of did seem to happen. So here's the next step, a picture of the solar system from outside it. Where's Earth in that?
Right there, that's us, one little pixel.
And this massive picture, it's huge. You can't even display it in a useful way because it's so huge. But one tiny little pixel in this picture is us, is our whole planet. So there's a question already. How do you think about Earth from that perspective, from the perspective of a single planet sending its first emissaries to the stars, just images and other things? So what happened was that kind of on the fly, the astronomers and space engineers that put this mission together decided, well, we have to send some kind of information about who sent, include some information about who sent this probe and what civilization was like and all this. And so this is a picture of part of it. You want to?
Right, so this is the golden record that was attached to the Voyager spacecraft. It's got the instructions on it for how to play the record in the top left, in the top right. It's got our position in space on the bottom left. It tells a little bit about timing in the bottom right with pictures of hydrogen atoms. And you might notice in the right center, there's a picture of a circle such that they could play this record, take the data from that, and if they decode it correctly, they should see a circle. And then after that, aside from the sounds of Earth, which were recorded on that album, and you heard some of those on the way in, both music that they recorded and greetings in various languages, including greetings from whales, or sounds from whales.
Yes.
They included several photos stored on the record. So let's take a look at the kinds of images that they chose. The first few images were ones chosen to convey our mathematics. So first, the circle. If they're able to make that circle, then they've decoded it correctly. A little bit about our mathematics, our number system. The bottom left is our inner solar system. The bottom right tells where we are in the galaxy again, encoded in a picture, and then a picture of a galaxy nearby. A little bit about our genetic makeup and our knowledge of DNA, the chemicals that go into that. And then a little bit about us as humans, diagrams showing conception, showing gestation of humans, little baby humans, and then families of various sizes, showing numbers and weights or masses for those humans.
Of course, whether this makes any sense to aliens is another matter. And that's actually a really important point. For example, upper left picture. So who sent this? Well, there are pictures of these bipedal creatures, but there's lots of other things, like how would the aliens know that we weren't tadpoles? That's what we're looking at in the upper left, right? Maybe that's us. Well, it actually is us in a certain way, right? But or these little, what we know as fetuses or embryos, but actually maybe that's us. So it's hard enough to interpret images as we just were doing when humans made them of humans and to some extent for humans, but these are schematic drawings made for aliens. So how they would actually read them, we don't know, but we do the best we can. This one was, if you look at the two photos on the right, keyed to, oops, there's another set, same ones, keyed to photographs.
The family on the right is a multi-generational family in the Ozarks. And so you can see the photos in the background are their ancestors. But then I believe you've got five generations being depicted there in one photograph. That it's they've got some very old and some very young people in it. Along with the photos in the background, so they're trying to show the age span, what humans look like at different ages. Versus on the left, that photo was intended to show. If you go back to the diagram would have had a baby inside of her to show this is what a woman looks like when she's pregnant.
It's kind of cool how they're trading the schematics and the photos, although, again, from a even another human, let's say, anthropological point of view or something, it's not really clear what someone would make of it. But it is kind of cool when you think about, like, and look at the way the figures intertwine, right? So, or the same figure and schematic and then not. So there is some attempt to connect it all. Although, again, like, if you look at the picture of the multi-generational thing, why would you think, even as humans, that the main point of it was that it was multi-generational, as opposed to maybe the most important thing are the pictures on the wall, whatever they are.
Yeah.
So again, it's tricky, but they are making an effort within the, at least as far as they can, with schematics and abstractions, to connect the pictures and to highlight what they want to be highlighting.
And by far, most of the images on there were not schematics, but were images, photos.
For example.
What could you discern from humans from these photos? You can shout it out.
I guess it didn't work.
People of different colors, obviously. On the top left, they're also around a globe. The intent probably to suggest that they're, you know, trying to connect to different parts of the world, that people live across different spots of the world. That's an interpretation I don't know if the aliens would actually get. Let's try the next one.
The aliens, just one thing, the aliens might have, if they were scanning Earth, if they could figure that out, where the, because there is a indication on the plaque on the spacecraft where they came from, they might see the continents, so they might be able to connect that to the upper left picture. Anyway, here's a cool one.
This includes our bottom right one, but the other photos also, you know, there's another, what is this, does this set of photos as an ensemble portray? What do these photos as an ensemble portray? Food. What's specifically about food? Because it's not just, well, like, bottom right was eating food. What? We have to get it, right? So someone has to go actually harvest food. What about the top right one? What's weird about that photo? It's a minor thing. Maybe it's not weird for you. It's weird for me.
Be weird for
you. You can't see it in the back. She's got grapes in her hand. And she's eating one in the store. That's a little uncommon. Maybe not. Maybe people just walk through the grocery store and eat while they're in there. But this was meant to portray we go and buy food. But how do you convince the aliens that you're shopping for food? They had to show her eating food in the store. So just like in the bottom picture, they exaggerated the eating. Likewise here, they had to show that the things that she was shopping for were food. That this was one step in the process.
Okay, quick commentary. So think about, we started by saying, you know, an astronomical view of beyond Earth, and I'm a philosopher. So here's this is a really deep and difficult question. How do you portray, how do we understand who we are? And once you get that sort of semi in order, how do we portray that in some comprehensible way to minds that we have no kinship with, we have no idea who they are, what they are, how they think, how many billions of years they might have been around, who knows what. So we're trying to pick images, and it makes sense. You think about we're organic beings, you think about food and whatnot, but if you even back out a little bit from our human embodiment and all that, just look at these again with another, like an, if you can, a little bit of an alien eye. Like, for example, it's true, people don't eat in supermarkets, so from the point of view of trying to do two things with the image at once, show the availability of food and show that it is food, that's not a bad attempt. But honestly, it makes no sense at all from even a slightly other human point of view, let alone an alien. Well, how would you know that there's even food? Like, it might be a museum or something. Like, so there's a, so, and maybe that, maybe she's not eating. Maybe there's some ritual involved with taking things into your mouth. Well, how do they even know it's a mouth for that matter? So you see, this isn't the easiest thing, figuring out how to portray the human to another kind of mind entirely. Or here's another way to think of that. The picture on the left. So we say that, oh yeah, well that's fishing, okay? Well, first of all, you don't see any fish, so that's a little hard to tell. And these nets. So, but maybe they could figure out that it had something to do with procurement of nourishment, maybe. Well, okay. What if you're a fish? What's that a picture of if you're a fish? That's not a picture of... that's not a picture of procuring nourishment. That's a picture of, like, being torn out of your native environment and reduced to someone else's food, right? It's a picture of oppression. Maybe the point of this particular transmission is a plea for liberation. Like, we need to have, the aliens need to come and stop this process of ripping beings out of their natural environment and turning them into meat. So like a vegetarian species. So you see what I'm saying? This is a really tricky business to try to even slightly step out of a human perspective to construct images like this. But that's an interesting project at this very same moment. That's like beyond Earth as well. And it frames our own question, who are we? And who are we in relation to the rest of this planet? So, nextly.
So another set, here's four again out of the over 100 images that were sent. This obviously portrays transportation. What can you glean about transportation on Earth from these photos? If you'd never been to Earth, what can you figure out? What do humans know how to do?
First of all, can you even tell that it is transportation? That's one thing.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I mean, nothing's moving, right?
So it's all static.
Hmm?
You're right. It's all static. Nothing's moving. What could you tell about humans from looking at this photo?
Rickshaw traffic jam. Even if it was transportation, it's not moving, right? But even apart from that, how do we know?
I'll pick on you guys. What can you tell about humans from this photo?
Go ahead. What? We've come a long way. So it's okay. So he's saying, if you get, are those rickshaws or what? Anyway, the upper left to the lower right. If you know what those are, you can say we've come a long way. Now we're in space. I don't know that you would know what they were, but if you did, yeah.
So yeah, you can tell that we're in space in the bottom right. Right. Well, if you assume that that's a human, and it kind of looks like it's got legs-ish, maybe an arm.
I mean, I was about to say the same thing. Essentially, yeah, it shows the development, especially in like transportation, I guess, amongst cars in the top left picture, the bottom left one.
All right, so you can see cars in varying states. The concept of flight in the top right. Not much else, though. You wouldn't call it an airplane, and you wouldn't know if that plane is going into space or if it's just going to Detroit.
Or going anywhere. We don't even know that, really.
And you don't know that there's people in it. It could just be launching something, or that could be a robot in the bottom right. Oh my gosh, true story.
Could be
hovering. I saw Star Wars the first time. No, this relates directly to that. Literally, when I saw Star Wars at age 6 and the stormtroopers come in, I didn't know if those were people wearing outfits or if they were robots. Cuz how would you know? No one had ever seen Star Wars before. Versus we just had two robots in there. And so, yes, you're right. Until you have some other indication, you can assume that maybe it's a robot or maybe it's a human.
So there are two sides to this. This is a worthy project. Well, lots of sides, but two of them are. It's a worthy project to try to portray the human in this way. And it's infinitely tricky. And both of those are beyond Earth, a beyond Earth perspective reveals, I think. Should we do the music? You want to?
So we'll play some music for you in a little bit. One of the last sets of photos in this series was the segue into the music, because they, as I was playing before, they included music on there from multiple different cultures, including Johnny B. Goode, which is one that has been mentioned in the press a lot recently. But they wanted to show what the concept of music was, and so it had this quartet plus an image of sheet music and a violin next to it. If you want to listen to it on your own, because we're not going to play the whole thing today because it's quite long, you can either listen to the greetings from Earth in various human languages, which is a very short playlist on Spotify, or if you just want background music while you're studying, interesting one on the right, the Voyager Golden Record playlist is a good one to pick up to listen to music hand-selected to represent various cultures around the Earth. We'll play some of that for you in a little bit.
So take a breath, nice deep one. Like, you're going to need some oxygen now. thank goodness for oxygen, right? That's part of our planet too. So what we've done is we've tried to step a little bit beyond Earth in this, so far, this project we have here together, both to ask how to think about being an Earthling from this point of view that now is just a little bit off the planet, and also about the, perhaps, as I was saying a minute ago, kind of the infinite trickiness of trying to do that at all when we have to think about ourselves from an alien perspective. So we have a little project. That's the kind of the rest of the session, one way or the other. Here's a question. What about you? Suppose it was you. These folks in NASA, Carl Sagan, you've probably heard of, and some of his cohort, kind of basically did this on the, by the seat of their pants on the fly when they realized pretty far along in the planning for these missions, Pioneer and Explorer, and spacecraft were already partly constructed. They said, oh yeah, we should like do this, put images, represent Earth. So they kind of talked to their friends, they took pictures of people they knew, all this, put together the playlist that way. So it was kind of a seat of the pants thing. Anyway, even if it hadn't been, it's a project that we could bring to you. So that's the second part of what we're gonna do next. There's something before that, but this is what we want you to think about. What image would you use to represent our world to those beyond Earth? Because it could be your choice, your question as well.
And before doing that, we want to pose that question to each other and sort of challenge the two of us to say, well, if there's only one picture to represent Earth, what would we put? To get you in the mindset for this, rather than getting into an alien's head, I want to see if you can just get into an astronomy professor's head. I chose this picture to represent all of Earth. My question for each table, and you're going to have a few minutes for this, what can you tell about Earth and why did I choose this picture? I chose it for a very specific reason. You have 5 minutes, and go to it.
And people in the back, you might want to come up and just have a closer look.
You can come up. I strongly encourage you can take a look at it up front while we're playing the music. That was the easy question. What do you see in the photo? Sky, water, trees, mountains, earth. Like you have the sort of the land and sky and water. But even on the land, it's broken up into sort of dirt, vegetation. Yeah.
She is looking off into the distance.
She's looking off into the distance. So her perspective matches ours as the viewer of the image, right? She's looking at the same thing that we're looking at. And there's a her there, like there's a human in the picture. There's three humans in the picture, right? Two of them up in the upper left. This was meant sort of as an astronomer that worked part-time for the government doing remote sensing when you would look point telescopes down rather than up, and also as an astronomer that's looked at other worlds, sometimes you need this ground truth where they can see what Earth looks like from space, you know, because aliens would be in space, but they wouldn't know exactly how those things correspond to the things that are on the ground. And so while some images, like the pictures of the inside of this room, would be very difficult for them to decipher because they don't know what the scale or the size of any of those things are. They know we have clouds. They know that we're covered with water. They know that there's large tracts of terrain, and a lot of that's covered with vegetation. So this gives them some sort of ground truth and then shows a few humans in there in the midst of it. It wasn't meant to convey everything about Earth, but it was meant to be a nice bridge between the things that they would see from their perspective and things that we might beam out with our TV stations and radio and that sort of thing, where we're not intentionally sending, but they could try to go from a picture of space to I Love Lucy, and in the middle they'd see this, although I guess they would think that was Lucille Ball then if they were watching I Love Lucy. Oh, yeah, yeah, and the clouds in there, like, it gives you a sense of the scale height for the clouds. you know, that's an important thing to sort of see that we've got an atmosphere and structure in that rather than a pretty blanket sky, although they would know that we had that. But sort of seeing that from underneath and the perspective is another helpful thing. It also would tell them something about our perception of those, that, you know, that's how clouds would look to us. You know, if we had slightly different eyes, if we were seeing an infrared instead, then we're not going to see, you know, out into space at all, that the infrared would block most of that. And so this picture says something about what we're able to see versus what, you know, someone else would see, that it captures the photons, the light that we think's important, not necessarily the light that they might have thought was important. So that was the easy one. Let's try another one. Anthony?
Okay, so before I show it, this one's mine that's coming. Just a little introduction. So, astronomer, philosopher, okay? So what Tony, Professor Crider, did was to use his photo, this one, to mediate, to start from the alien and astronomical perspective, outside perspective on the Earth. You would see clouds, you'd see water, you'd see landmass, and to take those already known aspects and show them from the surface, show them from the inside, and then put the human in it and everything. So that's a connective, like a bridge project. That's one way to do this. My image, I want to like kind of give you a hint, I guess, or a frame for thinking about this. I guess in one for now, one place I start with this is thinking, okay, this is one image. Because the question for you will be a little bit different, but the question that we posed to each other was, what if we had one image, and we had to do it in one image, this presentation of Earth? And so one thing I think about that as like a strategy for image choosing is that it probably is going to have layers, because there's more than one thing to convey. So somehow there have to be multiple. Also, the other thing is, you know, aliens aren't going to look at this for 5 minutes. They're going to look at it for 5 years or maybe 500 years or so. You know, you can be complex. So layers, that's the first thing. And the second thing is another level of information would be, how do the layers relate? So not just that you would be having different tracks or aspects in the different layers, but also that the layers, the relation of the layers might also be important. So those are two hints, okay? So we'll talk about it later, but here it is. This is also a particular image from a particular place and time which you might know, but again, the aliens aren't gonna know, like historically, they aren't gonna know what this is. So think about it just from what you can see. And so you have 5 minutes again, and also, I would particularly suggest folks in the back come up and, or at least send a representative from your table up to have a closer look. Okay, good luck. All right. So, let's think about this together. This is tricky, this is hard, this is, and again, I'm really thinking, if this were anything like a real situation, one thing that would happen would be people, the beings, whoever received this, would pore over it for like decades. So it would take some time, and you're just looking really quickly, you know, okay. But let's just think about this. So, what are a couple things you notice? Oh, don't tell the people what it is yet. Well, one thing, that's right, and we'll come back to that. But no, most the aliens wouldn't know that, right? Aliens wouldn't know that. What do they know? But you could translate that into something that they could figure out. There's a structure. Okay, so one layer, I said before, think of layers. So one layer, and in terms of the physical arrangement of it, it may be, it's still not totally clear, but maybe it's the back layer, but anyway, one layer is a structure. And the structure is formally symmetrical, whether it's whatever it might actually be, but it's a type. We know what the type is. The type is a formal building. It's very, and if you got closer, you would see that the the pediments and the arrangement of the windows and the doors and the frieze and the dome itself. It's all a very tightly formal symmetrical structure. So on one level, there's that. What's that suggesting? What does that reveal? Well, at least in part, it reveals a builder's. Somebody made that. That's not probably, I mean, it's true, we don't know for sure, but all the possible ways in which life and planets could go, but probably that was created by, that was built by maybe the folks who sent the message, maybe. Okay, so there's that. What's the other layer, another layer? Come on, people, what else is in the picture, yeah? There's something on the top of the, yeah, on the, yeah. So the, well, they're stuck on this structure that the maker, yeah, exactly. So they're not presumably the actual beings, but representations of the beings, and made of the same material. So there's something, so maybe those are the, well, who knows? For whatever reason, the builders chose to represent some kind of organic being on the structure. But let's say that's part of the structure layer. What's the other thing that's in the picture, obviously, is what? A lion, thank you. So, but what's the lion, like, how did the lion get in there? How is the lion related to the building? The lion is in front of the building, somehow superimposed on it. Being human and knowing something about our technologies, you can say it's projected, which it is. It's projected on them. Even if you didn't know that, there would be a front layer and a back layer, let's say. I mean, again, you can contest any of this, but let's say it's a pretty good guess. So somehow, on the front of this building, there is, and the building is this formal structured thing made by the builders, there's something else. And the something else is radically different. It's not symmetrical, it's not formal, it's not made of a fixed kind of rigid structure like even the statues, but it's a flowing being, it's got color unlike the rest. Okay, so there's two, so at least there are two layers, and one of them is the formal structure and the other is the organic or the natural or the something like that. And the, you know, you can add certain things like in context, the creature has two eyes and it's looking at you, the lion. Okay, so let's just say that for starters. You got that. Those are some layers. Now, what's the relation between the layers? The organic is projected on the structure. How is the structural usually, in our experience, possibly in the evolution of any intelligent species, how is the organic related to the built? It's the other way around, right? The built emerges out of the organic. So a building, you show a picture of a building, what you see is nature with a building in it, right? This is building with the nature in it, as it were. Well, a picture of the nature, it isn't actually nature. It's a picture. It's a picture of a picture of nature, right? So what's going on with this? Why would a civilization, so this is one, like I said, one picture. It's got layers, it's got to do a lot of work. What is the work that it's doing? It's somehow being done by the relation of the layers. The layers are the natural superimposed on the structural, which is the reverse of an order that in some way logically you'd expect. What's the message of that? I know I'm going fast here. What, and that's a rhetorical question, okay. What's the message of that? This is what I'm after. Well, go ahead. They are related, yes. They got to be related. They're in the same image and they come from the same sender. But the sender's trying to say something about the relation. What's the sender trying to say about the relation? All right, here's what I think. Go ahead. Okay, so we're into it. It's something about the relation, at least what I'm after, something about the relation between the two layers and power. But actually, I wonder about how powerful the lion is. The structure is not dependent on the lion, but the lion is dependent on the structure. Cora. So that's a good Earth Day moral. but maybe it's a picture of power and the primacy of the natural, to give it a fancy title, the primacy of the natural. Actually, so this is great, and I appreciate the ideas, but we want to give you a chance for something. So let me say what I think. This is really interesting. My intention was exactly the opposite. To me, this is a picture of a civilization in trouble. Why? Because the natural is now dependent on the structured. So that the lion is actually transparent. You get close enough and you can see the structure through the lion. The natural world is now at the mercy of the constructed world. And that's a civilization in trouble. It's no longer organically related. It doesn't emerge organically out of the world. The world, what's left of it, is dependent and projected and derivative. So somebody said about what this actually was a picture of. Let's go back to you. You said what you want to explain what it is?
It's the Vatican in Rome, and I kind of just Googled animals on buildings and
You did research. Okay. Yeah. This is a very famous, it's a part of a famous series. When Pope Francis became Pope in 2014? He's a radical in a variety of ways. And he named himself after Saint Francis, who was the patron saint of the animals. When his first encyclical came out, which is called Laudato Si, which means we will praise you, but it's an encyclical about the human relation to the environment. He's really saying we need to remember that we exist within creation and we are part of creation, and creation is much vast, organic creation is much vaster and all this. So it's a profoundly environmental message. So one thing that happened is that people made this a slideshow, which was projected onto the Vatican. This very powerful moment. He also got a huge lot of flack for this because people said it was pagan and it was representing the animal as divine and all these things, and it was violating the central symbol of Christendom and stuff. And again, aliens wouldn't know this, right? But the function of this in history was to really break a lot of things open, assumptions about the relation of the human and the natural. But so that's what it is historically. But again, to me, if you read it as an image that we might represent the state of our civilization with, it doesn't necessarily matter that it's the Vatican or people were talking about U.S. Capitol or whatnot. It's the structure of the building and the derivativeness of the animal. So that's my intention with this. So I appreciate other readings of that. It is, of course, tricky.
Of course, if you're going to argue that this is a picture of biology going away and technology taking its place, then if all the aliens are robots, they're going to say, yes, this civilization has finally emerged. They've gotten rid of their biological past, and they're moving on to a technological present. And so,
sayonara lions, right?
Yeah, so we got rid of the lions. Now we can build the robots. Great. Yeah. Yes, they're finally emerging on the intergalactic scene. Question over here.
There actually were a variety, a lot of them were, there's, I don't know, about 50 slides. Many are animals. There's some fish scenes with schools of fish. There are forests. There's some human ones, mostly not white suburbanites, but like other people. But most of it is like this, yeah. You should look, you can see it on YouTube and stuff. There are films of this.
And so now our challenge for you. There are about 100 of you here. Let's imagine we were collecting 100 photos from you that will be all that is left to represent Earth. Your job is to imagine that all of you collectively are creating a new set of photos for a new golden record, and those photos collectively will represent Earth. What piece of Earth do you want to represent? So take a few minutes for that.
Images are flowing in, 100 pictures of Earth. Every single, most of you have like just cruising around a little bit and looking. Most of you have lots and lots and lots of pictures. And think, just one little useful thought prompt. Every single picture is a picture of Earth. Everything you've got in the picture is an Earthling, right? That's you, your friends, your dog, trees, mountains, rivers, bridges, all that kind of stuff. We're seeing a lot of that. But let me tell you something that can happen. So these spacecraft that are flying off through through interstellar space for tens of thousands or maybe millions of years, memory can degrade, okay? Sometimes only some of what's sent will actually survive. That's true even in human history. There have been all kinds of accidents, and not sometimes not just accidents. There were deliberately destroyed libraries repeatedly in human history. The Library at Alexandria was burned down by early Christians because it had pagan images, and countless treasures from the ancient world were lost. And it isn't just in ancient times. It was in Sarajevo when the Serbs were besieging the city. They deliberately destroyed the National Library, Sarajevo National Library, which was a repository of the multi-ethnic heritage of Bosnia. Here's a picture of the Mayan Codex, which is one of the few things that survived from the Mayan period. And again, throughout Central and South America, whole repositories of cultural memory from the native peoples were deliberately destroyed by the Spanish, deliberately burned because they weren't Christian, because they were pagan, because the whole idea was to destroy the culture, which they succeeded in doing in large part. So the moral of the story is sometimes there's a lot of loss. Transmission isn't 100%. As it happens, in the case of your photographs, assuming there are about 100 of you, the transmission rate turns out to be 4%.
So we have four random photos that we selected very quickly and completely randomly. This is what you have chosen to represent Earth.
These are the four that get through right now. Dun, 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 dun. There they are.
So take a minute at your table, and I want you to construct a story of Earthlings based on just these four photos. All right? You'll construct a story of Earth just on these four photos. Take a minute at your table. What do you know about this?
This is the same project you just did, except now they're your photos, right? What does this say about Earth? This is what survives to aliens get. Good afternoon. A room full of Elon University students here in suburban Burlington, North Carolina, has been challenged and tasked with the question of how do you interpret a set of images that might be sent off the planet to other civilizations. And we're here to interview some of the students and find out their results, starting with you. What do you see in this picture? What have you and your group seen in it?
We see civilization and nature.
Civilization and nature. Tell us more about that.
Let me hold it. So at the bottom right, there's two, it looks like wolves, and you can see their hearts, but you also see that their hearts are being held by hands. And I'm really not, the wolves in the bottom corner with hearts and hands holding the hearts kind of represents that, one, we have anatomy, that there's more to us than just our bodies or just the animals' bodies. No, I said, or the animals' bodies. And it also shows that there are hands, and that hands are capable of grabbing things, which is really essential to humans, although it doesn't really correlate with hands and wolves and opposable thumbs, you know.
Thank you. Whose picture is that, just by the way? Tell us about it. Art project, study of symmetry. Why'd you pick it? Huh. Okay. Totally. Yeah. Typically, we haven't seen people pick drawings. That's really interesting. Yeah. What else do you see? What is a couple themes that emerge that people really? Yes, sir. So the two diagonal about upper right, lower left are all city, all not human, though the aliens might not figure that out entirely. Yeah. Well, both extremes exist on the planet, for sure. What about the ensemble? If you look at all four of them, remember, this is what they get, and this is it. What message is that perhaps sending?
As a set, we've got two of them showing nature, right? And I can kind of make a story that, like, maybe the set would be representing that or half of the world is nature and one quarter of it is this technology or whatever that is. I can't yet figure out how to sort of weave into a story that brings in the bottom right, that connects the dots between all four. That usually you can pull together four images. Like, let me ask this. Which order do you think that one might assume the story was being told? Like, which one is, if this was a set of four, which one is picture number one, picture number two, picture number three, picture number four, and why? Back there. All right, so sort of circling that way, sort of bottom right, bottom left, top right. All right, that's a good interpretation. Huh.
What if you ended with the top left? I thought that's what you were saying at first. Would that be a more optimistic portrayal? Humans, well, I mean, one thing about these stories is that they're very human-centric to start with. Like, we're really concerned about how the human relates to the rest of it. Maybe humans don't really matter that much, so we could think about that from that perspective. But if we did, if it was a story about us, maybe it could end with a person in nature. All nature, I don't know about how the drawing fits in, but the other three, all nature, all metal, and then the person back in nature somehow. Could be a hopeful message. We need to wrap up,
yep.
I think.
So that was our interpretation of Beyond Earth Day. Asking ourselves again to either think beyond traditional Earth Day or to think about a day in which we think about our world as seen beyond Earth. Thanks for playing along with us today. We hope you enjoy the
Go
rest
Earth.
Of your weekend.
Go Earth! Go Earth! Some way or other. Thank you all.